So, as I said, thank you for the kind introduction and most of all for the invitation, because I'm really glad to talk about my research here with you. First of all, I want to thank my advisors because the talk is about my PhD project, and I want to thank Francesco Ballarin and Professor Gianluigi Rozza for their guidance through this journey. So let's start with the beginning of this journey. We started actually thinking about applying reduced order modeling to optimal control problems in environmental sciences. Now, the problem with environmental sciences is twofold. Indeed, on one side, they are based on data. However, data are noisy or difficult to interpret, most of all, expensive to collect. So basically, you don't want to rely on data for your research. And you need simulations in order to recover the behavior of your data. However, these simulations are related to parametric PDEs usually, and the parameter can represent physical information or geometrical features. And these PDEs are usually very time-consuming and related to very time-consuming activities like parameter estimation, statistics, so uncertainty quantifications and inverse problems, so on and so forth. So you can tackle these issues on one side through reduced order modeling, because reduced order modeling gives you a way to work in a low-dimensional framework and simulate a lot of phenomena for several parametric instances in a fast way. I will be more detailed later. And on the other, through optimal flow control. Now, optimal control is a mathematical tool that let you be more variable, let's say, because add data information in your model, add data information in your model. So here in the bottom of the slide, you see a pipeline of optimal control. It is an input-output structure. So as an input, you have your PDE, your data, and the parameter. And now you have also this control variable that changes the behavior, let's say the classical behavior of your PDE, in order to minimize cost functional to obtain an optimal solution that eventually is similar to the data that you collect. Now, in a parameterized setting, the problem is that if the parameter changes, basically everything changes, and you want to avoid to do everything from scratch. You would like to exploit the parametric structure of your problem. Now, optimal control can be really useful in several applications in environmental sciences. We will see some of them during the talk, like water height control or pollutant control in the Gulf of Trieste. This is a slow movie, but actually here, this is a pollutant concentration that it's moving and it's going in the Gulf, and you want to study how it moves. And here, for example, we see a very classic problem in aerodynamics, but this can be also interpreted as a riverbed. So maybe you want to avoid one of the two configurations that you see here, one that is Wohlhagen solution and the other one that is straight. So this is an outline of the talk, but I don't want to spoil much. We will see some methodology. So the first part is about methodology, and the second part is about applications, but I want to take advantage of this slide to thank my collaborators. So first of all, Professor Stevenson and Giuseppe Carrere from the University of Amsterdam, and also Federico Picchi from EPFL. Last but not least, I want to underline that all the experiments have been coded through two open source libraries that we develop at SysMATLAB, that are called they are called Multiphenix and Ervenix, and they are open source. You can go to the web page, and basically you can play with the tutorials if you are interested in PDEs and parameterized setting. So let's start with the actual talk. We will go through the problem formulation and the space-time discretization. So this is the slide of the continuous problem formulation. Let's go through this slide together. So given a parameter in a parametric space, I want to find a solution Y and a control U in some Hilbert spaces, okay, with some regularities in space and time. And here I've written the spaces. And this solution is actually a solution of the minimization problem that you see here. So you want to minimize this cost functional constrained to this PDE. So this is a PDE in weak formulation that depends on the state, on the time evolution of the state, and on the control, as you can see. As I said, the control changes the classical behavior of your solution in order to minimize, let's say, the distance between your solution and an observation that represents your data, okay? So the data that you may collect in real applications. The data can be collected in a subset of your domain, and also the control can act on a subset of your domain. It can be a forcing term all over the domain, on a subset, or even on the boundary. Now, the control wants the state to be the most similar to the data that you see here. However, it is weighted with respect to a parameter alpha, that is a penalization parameter. So you have to imagine that the smaller is alpha, the most your system will be controlled, right? Because the norm of you will weight not much on the system, and so you will minimize a lot your system. How can you solve the problem? Well, we applied classical Lagrangian approach. This is, a classical approach for constraint minimization. So we define another variable, the adjoint variable that has the role of the Lagrangian multiplier. We define this Lagrangian functional given by the previous functional plus the PDE constraint tested with respect to the adjoint variable. So you want to find the stationary point of this Lagrangian. So you differentiate with respect to the three variables. You put everything equal to zero, and the solution y and u of this stationary point is actually a minimum for this problem. So if we think about the problem in strong formulation, we have something like that. So you have a forward equation with the time evolution of the state and a backward evolution for the adjoint equation, and you have this relation between control and adjoint. Now the and boundary conditions. Now the existence and uniqueness of this problem can be proved through standard mixed variational theory, so Bretzky theorem, basically, assuming the same space for state and adjoint, okay? And part of my thesis was actually working on and building on papers that were about steady problems and enlarging them and building on them in order to prove and all the results also for unsteady problems. So the technique that we use is the space-time discretization. So what you obtain once you have proved that your continuous formulation is right and you want to discretize your problem in order to solve it, it's a one-shot unsteady system of this form. It is a saddle point problem, as you can see from the blocks that I have highlighted here. And the structure is very similar to a steady problem here, but actually I'm wiping stuff under the carpet because each board symbol hides all the time instances, okay? And each time instance is a finite element discretization. So each variable is a space-time variable of dimension calligraphic n equal to nh times nt, where nh is the spatial discretization dimension, in my case was finite element, and nt is the time discretization dimension. So since I am a bit cheating, let's say, what is the real structure of the matrix? For example, if we focus only on the blue rectangle, we have something like this. This is the matrix notation for the controlled state equation, and you see that even if they are only two matrices, the system can be huge, right? So you have to imagine that the whole system is quite big to solve, and it is unfeasible to solve for real-time applications or in contests where you have to do a lot of simulations for several parameters. And this is the reason why we moved towards reduced order modeling. And the first thing I want to show you is a very common algorithm for reduced order modeling in a space-time fashion. So proper orthogonal decomposition in a space-time fashion. First of all, I want to introduce you the reduce or the models, the reduce or the models ideas. So the goal of reduce or the modeling is to achieve the same accuracy of the space-time solution that here I called delta calligraphic n, that can be one of the three solutions, the three variables. The same accuracy of the space-time in a low-dimensional framework at reduced cost. How can I do that? Well, as I said, you start with your continuous formulation and you apply a space-time discretization and you have your first approximation. Now, assuming that your approximation is fine enough, you can actually do an approximation of the approximation. So another stage of approximation. You build a subset of your previous space-time space of dimension capital N, and then you project everything with standard Galerkin projection in this low-dimensional framework, and you obtain another discretization, so the reduced discretization. The main thing is that basically this discretization is fast to achieve, okay, once you have built everything. Now, how can I build the space? And you can use a standard algorithm like POD, or you can call it PCA or SPD in other fields, but we call it POD, proper orthogonal decomposition, that is an explore and compress algorithm. So basically, here, let's go through the drawing together. You take a lot of snapshots. With the word snapshot, I mean a space-time solution computed in a parameter. Okay, so you take a lot of parametric instances of your problem, let's say n max, you build the covariance matrix, you solve an eigenvalue problem, and you retain only the n eigenvectors related to the n largest eigenvalue of the problem. This is a basis of your space, of your subspace, and in the end you project everything. The important thing is that capital N is much lower than calligraphic N, as I said. So you are actually gaining a lot of time to do a lot of simulations for several parameters. However, there is an issue in reduce order modeling. If you want to tackle problems like that, so in a saddle point formulations, the problem is well posed when these three conditions are verified. These are the hypotheses of the Bretzi theorem. So the first condition, so the continuity of the bilinear form associated to the orange block and the continuity of the bilinear form associated to the blue block is directly inherited from the space-time formulation. As well, also the coercivity of the orange block over the kernel of the blue block is inherited from the previous discretization. But the in-sub condition over the controlled equation, over the controlled state equation, is actually verified when you have the same space for state and adjoint, also at the reduced level. So now you can understand that basically this can be not the case for the POD, because the basis deriving from a POD applied to the adjoint variable can be actually different from the one of the state variable. And the solution is quite simple because you put everything together. So you build a common space for state and adjoint given by the union of the basis for state and adjoint. So that basically you are enlarging the space where you want to reach the Babuska in subcondition here. Now I want to show you some first results for the POD. The first application is actually a cost of water height control, and it is represented by shallow water equations. Shallow water equations is a system where you have not only the velocity field of your problem, but also the water height. Okay, so here you see the functional. Basically, we want to minimize the distance between a desired height and a desired velocity, where U here is a forcing term. The forcing term can represent wind action, bottom friction. So you see that it's very difficult to control activity, these properties. However, it can be also seen as an inverse problem in the sense that you want to understand features that gives you a desired profile. Now, maybe I can be a little bit clearer with this drawing. So this is a wave, and maybe you don't want this wave, that is a high wave, to impact your harbor or your shores. This is the reason why you can apply optimal control to reach a flatter behavior like that, for example. Now, in the bottom of the slide, you have all the information about the problem. Here we have only physical parameters. However, we tried also geometrical parameters. With geometrical parameters, I mean that basically you can change, for example, the shape of the domain you're working on. And we moved also towards geometrical parameters with no issues. And you can see that here, we solved n max problem equal to 100, and we retain only capital N basis equal to 30. Okay, that is a small number with respect to calligraphic N, as you can see. Some results now. So on the top of the slide, you see the finite element approximation of the water height. This is a Gaussian water height that actually goes down in a square pool, let's say. And you see the height for several time instances. And we were able to recover this, this behavior with ROMs, let's say in an identical way. There is no difference in the plots. As you can see, indeed, the errors are quite good. And we are reaching also a good speed up. With the word speed up, I mean the number of reduced order simulation that you can do in the time of a space-time simulation. So actually it's an index on how fast you can go, right? And the speed up is given by the fact that we are solving a much smaller system with respect to the previous one, okay? So we are enlarging the spaces with the aggregated spaces technique, but as I said, it is needed in order to continue of the problem, and however we are reaching a speed up. But there is, an issue, because space-time formulation is a problem also for the building phase, because I told you that basically you need to solve a lot of problems, let's say hundreds of problems, and then compress all the information. This is the reason why we wanted to move towards classical algorithms like greedy, greedy algorithm in a space-time fashion for parabolic problems. Here we are talking about linear problems this time. So let me be a little bit more, let me be clear here. So as I said, the POD drawback as a costly building phase, okay? I told you that basically you have to solve n max snapshots. So I want an algorithm that is able to represent my solution, but like picking the parameters in a smarter way and solving only capital N problems, where capital N is actually the dimension of my reduced basis space approximation. Before going into the detail of the algorithm, I recall you this strong formulation, because for the reduced basis algorithm, the greedy algorithm, actually we used a different formulation. So as you can see here, there is this linear relation between a control and a joint variable, and you can actually derive a relation between the two and plug this relation in U. And in the end, basically, you can have only two equations, okay? So we used these formulations for a matter of computation, actually, because we had to prove the well-posedness of the problem, and everything was slightly better in this case. So the control can be recovered in the post-processing, and from now on, the whole optimality system in weak formulation will be written with this PEDEX OCP, okay? So if you apply standard Nekas-Babuska theory in mixed variational framework to this problem, you can prove existence and uniqueness of the solution, always assuming that Y and P are in the same space. Basically, you prove the injectivity and the surjectivity of the whole optimality system. And we were building on these two papers, one of Urban and Patera, that were applying reduced basis approximation, so space-time greedy, two parabolic partial differential equations. So we were trying to building on in order to achieve the same result for optimal control. Now, the space-time system that you have is similar to the previous one. You are getting rid of the control, but as I said, you can recover it in post-processing. And you can apply the space-time greedy and also aggregated space, because once again, you have to be careful to the well-posedness of the saddle point problem that you reach. But as I said before, here you are solving only capital N problems and not N max problems. Let's go through the detail of the space-time greedy. So here we consider the global space-time solution delta calligraphic N given by the aggregation of a state and adjoint variable in a space-time framework. Now the strategy is to build adaptively the spaces given this error estimator that you see here. So the error estimator is the estimator of the error between your space-time solution and the reduced approximation that you have. Now, given this error estimator, a tolerance and an initial parameter and a training set over your parameterized system, you initialize the spaces. So a reduced space for the state, like this, a reduced space for the adjoint, and you proceed thanks to some steps, and at the nth step, you choose the parameter as the one that is the worst for the error estimator. And then you take the snapshot for that parameter. So in order to enrich your space, so that basically you have you are sure that you are describing well all the other parametric instances in the training set that you had. And you continue until you reach convergence. And then, as I said, in the end, you put everything together because you want your problem to be well posed, because you are dealing with a saddle point formulation. Now the important thing is actually that capital N is much lower than calligraphic N, and that you are solving exactly capital N problems, okay? Because you stop with a tolerance and it is iterative. The main thing is actually this error estimator, okay? Because it's the most difficult part. You have to find this this certification, this error estimator. Now, for steady problems, we had a formula, let's say an explicit formulation for the error estimator given by the norm of the residual over the Babuska-Insub constant of the whole optimality system. So here you see the residual of the whole optimality system, here the Babuska-Insub constant of the whole optimality system, and this is an error estimator. However, there is an issue that is given by the computation of the Babuska-Insub, because the Babuska-Insub, if it is not explicit, you have to compute it through eigenvalue analysis, and an eigenvalue analysis is really expensive. So what is our contribution in an unsteady case? Well, first of all, we were able to prove the same relation of the unsteady problem in a space-time framework. And we found also a lower bound for the Babuska that is cheap to compute. So once you have a lower bound, you can actually prove this relation, and you can define a new error estimator that now is cheap to compute, as I said. Indeed, the error estimator is of this form, and all the quantities that you see here, you know them a priori, because alpha is given, the coercivity constants of your state, you can compute it, and there are continuity constants, and so you know everything, and you can, and it's really cheap to compute. If you solve, for example, a Babuska-Insub constant for a problem that is quite easy, it can take something like order of seconds, and now we reduced we were able to compute these quantities in a really small time, okay, less than seconds. And the main thing is actually that it does not depend on time. And this led us talk about, like, can we mirror all the results that we had in order to improve also this problem, so also the steady case. And we did. Indeed, all the results that I will show you later will be somehow comparative between steady and unsteady problems. So let's start with the results. So this is a Guides flow simulation. So you have an advection diffusion equation and you have a Peclet number that is parameterized, an observation that is parameterized, and the parameters. And the parameters are hidden also in the geometrical domain. Now, basically, you want to reach a desired temperature field. Now, follow me in this drawing. I think it's better. So here you have a Dirichlet boundary condition equal to one. You have your flow, and you want to control your flow at the exit here. So in this red dashed line, in order to achieve a desired temperature here in the top strip and in the bottom strip. And the desired temperature is given by a parameter. Okay, so as I said, mu1 is related to the Peclet number, mu2 is actually related to the geometry of the problem because mu2 stretches the domain. Okay, and here you find all the data. I want to stress that we were able to solve only capital M problems, and it is quite smaller with respect to the calligraphic M, so with respect to the space-time dimension. Sorry. Now some results. So basically, here we have our high fidelity solution, so our truth problem, our space-time problem on the left, and our reduced problem on the right. And we were able to recover the fields, okay, with pretty good errors, as you can see now in the table. Now the table actually compares the errors that we achieved through the employment of the Babuska lower bound and the exact computation of the Babuska. And you see that we are totally comparable. Here we have covered the control in post-processing and they match, okay, between control there is a match between space-time control and reduced space control. I will be more detailed later on these two plots. Now I want only to stress on the speed up. We reach very good speed up, so we can do a lot of reduced simulation in the time or space-time simulation. And I want to stress on the effectivity. Now the effectivity is a measure on how your estimator is good, in the sense in how your estimator is tied with respect to the standard error. And these values can seem high, however, they are comparable with other effectivities and given by other error estimators in literature for steady. As I said, we are not worsening our problem with the time evolution. You can go on with your time evolution with no problems. Now some comparative results between steady and unsteady problems. Here I'm showing actually a simpler example with no geometrical parameter and distributed control. With distributed control, I mean that the control is a forcing term all over the domain, okay, not only on the boundary. So this is a simpler setting. As you can see, you need only 13 bases. So you need a linear subspace of dimension 13 to represent the solution, both in an unsteady case and steady case, with comparable results. And now here the plots about the difference between the Babuska in soup and our lower bound. Now let's focus on this plot here on the top right of the slide. So you have to look the same colors. So for example, the blue, dark blue color for alpha equal to one, and the ballets are for the Babuska in soup, and the little stars are for the lower bound. That is a lower bound because it's always down, as you can see. And what happens here is that the behavior gets worse if we have smaller alpha. This is something that is very well known in literature, actually. It happens with all the error certification about optimal control problems for steady case. But I want to stress once again that this behavior does not change in the unsteady case. We are not worsening a lot our bound with the time, a little bit here for higher alpha, but we are going quite well for smaller value alpha. Another slide, last slide of this problem, where with comparative results with geometrical parameter and boundary control, so I am actually showing you the results about this problem I'm showing. So as I said, with the errors, we were good, both with the unsteady case and the steady case. However, for the steady, I need less basis. This was not unexpected, right? Because it's a simpler dynamic. But I want to stress a weakness, actually, of the certification that we did. Indeed, the bound, the lower bound, is really sensitive with respect to the parameter, the geometrical parameter. So if you stretch a lot the domain, you lose an order of magnitude in your time respect to the Babuska lower bound. We can see that here, for example, the Babuska lower bound for alpha equal to 1 is something like 10 to the minus 1, and you have 10 to the minus 3 for our lower bound if you are stretching a lot the domain. If you are dealing with a domain that is smaller, let's say, shorter in the long direction, in the x direction, you have that the Babuska soup does not change, but the bound is 10 to the minus 2. So we are gaining an order. So the weakness here is that if your problem is very complicated at geometrical level, you can struggle a little bit. Now I move to the second part of the talk about actually some interdisciplinary applications of optimal flow control. And the first part was about, let's say, a part of my PhD that, as I said, was focused on building on classical steady literature for optimal control and moving towards time dependency. But all the strategies that you have seen can easily adapt to steady problems. So from now on, we will see steady problems, but with some interdisciplinary flavor. The first thing I want to show is actually to use reduce order modeling for uncertainty quantification in environmental sciences. I want to thank my collaborators, so Professor Stevenson and Giuseppe Caire, and I want to thank them for their contribution in this work. So let's go through the problem. This is once again the pipeline of optimal control. And now the parameter is a random variable. It has basically a probability density distribution, so it is uncertain. And this uncertainty transfers from the input to the output. And research centers are really, or also, this is a thing also for industrial application. They are really interested in uncertainty quantification because you want to do a lot of statistics. The uncertainty is always present. Now, to do statistics, you need Monte Carlo methods. But Monte Carlo methods are based on a lot of simulations. This is the reason why you can use reduce order modeling to accelerate these simulations, okay? And we use very peculiar reduce order modeling technique that is called weighted ROM. Now, the weighted ROMs actually add information about the distribution of your parameter, okay, and it is also based on a smarter way to picking the parameters. Now, let me be clear here. So the standard POD algorithm gives you the n-dimensional subspace that minimizes the error that you see here, okay, in the space of the parameter. And this can be approximated with this summation. Now, the idea when you move towards uncertainty is like, okay, I have actually to minimize this expectation, okay, because now we are in a probability space setting. So you have an expectation over the square error, and you want to find a way to approximate this problem, and you can use a general quadrature rule with nodes given by the parameters and the weights of the parameters that are given by this small omega here. And most of all, you can also weight everything from the probability distribution, okay, Rho. And if I call all this W, so if it is my weight, how can I change the correlation matrix in order to add this information in the POD? It is not difficult because this is the correlation matrix, and now the new correlation matrix is actually like before, but with this multiplication weight. So this change in the correlation matrix can be really helpful, and I am showing you some results in a pollutant control application in the Gulf of Trieste. So basically here we imagined, we pretend a loss of pollutant in the green area that is in front of the city of Trieste. And we wanted the pollutant to be under a threshold in the red area that you see here that represented the naturalistic area of the Miramare Castle. Now the model is quite simple because it's an advection diffusion problem, and the parameters represent the wind action over the Gulf. And this is quite interesting because Trieste is a very windy region. So you may have this kind of representation of the Gulf, but sometimes you are in this kind of configuration and you want to predict and manage dangerous marine phenomena like pollutant loss. And in this case, the control is the maximum pollutant release that you can have in order to achieve the desired state that is your threshold, your safeguard threshold. Some results now. This is the uncontrolled solution. So this is the solution with U equal to the maximum release. And you can see that in order to achieve the threshold, you have to reduce in somehow the pollutant release. And this is the finite element simulation, and this is the POD simulation. And you can see that we were able to recover the field with no problems. We had pretty good errors, even with a small number of bases. It is a quite simple problem, actually. But now I want to stress a little bit on this. I want to stress a little bit on the results that you can see here on the average relative error. Now, here we are fixing the distribution, okay, and using several quadrature rules, and they were all comparable, but this is not unexpected because it is quite simple, and in literature it was known that basically it was what we expected. And now we fix the Monte Carlo quadrature rule and we change the distribution. As you can see, if the distribution is very informative, you need much less basis in order to achieve a tolerance on the error. And this can be really helpful if you know something about your distribution before. It is not always the case in environmental sciences, but however, this can be a good tool for environmental sciences. Now, the last thing I want to talk about is how optimal control can act on bifurcating phenomena arising from nonlinear PDEs in hemodynamics. This is a work with Federico Picchi, a colleague of mine, and we were talking and talking about actually the Coanda effect, we thought about problems. So now the starting point is how the blood flows in the mitral valve. So in our heart, there is the mitral valve and the blood flows in the mitral valve, and the blood can go straight like that. But if the heart is pumping quite strong, you can have something like that. So the flux attaches to the walls of your valve. So how can I describe it with simulation? First of all, the domain of the mitral valve can be represented by this sudden expansion channel, and the flow can be represented by Navier-Stokes equations. So now we have a parametrization given by the diffusivity parameter here. So if the parameter is small, basically your heart is pumping a lot. If the parameter is high, you have a Stokes type flow. Okay, so we are in this configuration here in the middle. Your blood goes straight. So if I run the simulation, What happens is that from this value of the parameter that I call bifurcation parameter, you will reach somehow the wall-hugging solution that is the natural one. As I told you, if your pump, if your heart pumps strong, you will reach this wall-hugging solution. However, you will find also this straight solution. So mathematically, there is a lack of uniqueness of the solution, okay? Another thing is that this is the natural phenomenon. So actually, you would like to avoid one of the two simulation, okay, in a good simulation setting. The wall-hugging solution, however, that is the physical one, it's a bad configuration for from the medical point of view, because it causes recirculation in your mitral valve. So there is another issue in the sense that the physically stable solution is the one that is not good for medical doctors. Mathematically, indeed, you can represent everything I told you with a pitchfork bifurcation diagram. So for example, if you plot, let's say, the value of the velocity in a point of your domain, like this, if you go from mu equal to 2 and then you decrease the value of mu, you will have two stable solution here, the yellow one and the green one, but an unstable solution that is one given by the straight flux. How can I study the stability properties of the solution? Well, I can linearize the system, study the eigenvalue, and look to the real part, look at the real part of the eigenvalue. And if the real part is always negative, you will have a stable solution. And as I said, for Navier-Stokes, uncontrolled Navier-Stokes is the wall-hugging one. While if the real part of the of your eigenvalue, this is the complex plane for the symmetric solution, you see that some of them are crossing the origin. So we are in the unstable setting. Now, our question was, how can I change these features in order to change the system and achieve the good solution, so straight one, with no bifurcation eventually? We put together a very simple optimal control problem. So we want our solution to be similar to Stokes flux in this case, over the end of the chamber, over this line, gamma ops. And we tried several controls. Now I will show you only the Midas control action and the strongest one. So the Midas control action is given by a Neumann control. So here you are actually controlling how the flux can exit your channel. And in this setting, we were able always to find two solutions. So actually the system is bifurcating, there is a lack of uniqueness. Given a parameter, given an alpha, for example, this alpha, we were able to find two solutions. However, there is a difference with respect to Navier-Stokes because at the end of the channel, there is a mild diffusivity effect. So we are actually controlling our system, but still we are not able to change the features of the stability, okay? Indeed, I'm not showing you the plots of the stability because they are really similar to these plots, okay? So for the sake of time and sake of simplicity, I'm avoiding that. But now, if we move towards the strongest control, so the Dirichlet control solution, we saw something really interesting, I think. So here we are actually let the velocity do whatever it wants in this orange line here and orange line here. So we are controlling actually the velocity here. And we were able to find only one solution. So we were not able to find other solution. We were not able to find bifurcation. Indeed, as you can see here, I'm plotting two solutions, but they are for different alpha. So for each alpha, we found only one solution. And for small alpha, we always found this straight solution here. And for high alpha, this is alpha equal to one. And for smaller alpha, we found this very strange solution that I call asymmetric, because you see that in the beginning of the channel, it has an asymmetric behavior that has a very, very diffusive effect. So we are controlling a lot of system. As we can see here, for example, this is the plot of the velocity field over the observation line domain. And the green solution is the controlled velocity for this value of alpha. And it is basically the same of the Stokes velocity field that is in blue. Okay, so we are controlling a lot of system. But what happens is that for this value of alpha, the flux goes out here, but is injected in order to achieve the diffusivity here. And this injection of flux causes this very strange behavior. But now if I show you the plots of the stabilities of the eigenvalues, something interesting is happening, because we were able to change the stability of the problem. Indeed, on the top, you see the uncontrolled plots of the Navier-Stokes and the Wohl-Hartley solution. So the one that is asymmetric is actually stable because everything is negative. But here, the asymmetric solution is actually unstable because you have some eigenvalues that are crossing the ology, while the straight solution, that is the one that does not cause problems in your heart, is the one that is natural. Okay, so you will find it in nature. Okay, it's the one that is stable, sorry, because everything is negative. However, something strange is happening, because here also complex eigenvalues are crossing the zero, and maybe we are not anymore in the pitchfork bifurcation diagram I showed you before. Maybe we are in a complex setting like of bifurcation. There is a lot to do, a lot to see about this problem. And we applied the reduced order modeling to the problem, and everything was fine. Basically, we use a branch-wise approach. So you take snapshot for, let's say, the Wohl-Hartley solution, and you want to reduce the Wohl-Hartley solution. You take snapshots from the straight solution, and you want to reduce that. And everything worked fine. Here you see a relative error with respect to capital N, and it decreases as N grows as expected. But a very interesting thing is that if you plot the error with respect to the parameter, it can be used as a post-processing way to understand when something bad is happening, because around the bifurcation you see a peak in the error. And for the Naumann case, that was very similar to Navier-Stokes equation, you see that we have the peak around 0.96 as expected. But for the Dirichlet problem, we basically translated the peak, and we do not know what happens later. So there's a lot to do, and I'm a bit over time, so I skip to the conclusions. This is only a summing up of what you have seen. There are a lot of things to do. We are trying to be more reliable with the data fields, with the non-intrusive techniques, so neural networks and so on. So there is another part about the preprocessing of the data that we are trying to take us somehow. But yes, now I want only to thank you, and I hope you enjoyed the talk as I enjoyed working on this stuff. Thank you.